check the participants. I think we can start. It's a great pleasure to present you one of our ARIS project topic. It's a part of our educational package, geomagnetic field, or the Earth's magnetic field. This presentation has been prepared by our expert of geomagnetism, Dr. Anne Neska. Dr. Neska works in the physical observatory at Belsk. This is situated about 50 kilometers from the center of Poland, from Warsaw, from our capital. And my name is Piotr Stankiewicz. I'm a methodological expert in our project, the ARIS project, but also, as you know, with another project, EduArctic. So I'm a geologist, and I work in the Institute of Geophysics, Polish Academy of Sciences. And my office is, of course, situated in the capital of Poland, in Warsaw. Okay, today I will try to answer why our compasses show the north direction. Or is it really north, or maybe not? I think we discussed this, and we'll give you some explanation, I think. I'd like to imagine that our Earth is a huge magnet. It's the really big inside the Earth. And all the space, there's a space around this, and the Earth magnetic field, or you can simply say that this is a geomagnetic field. Okay, so you can, if just a simple magnet, you can simply check that there are special field lines around this magnet, and this is our planet. So field lines run both, also in the interior of the Earth, but also in outer space. And you should know that the distance of the space around the planet is a distance of many tens of thousands of kilometers. So it is really space around our Earth. This geomagnetic field is present. Okay, so remember just one fact, that there is a big magnet inside the Earth. We'll try to find the magnet inside our planet. Look at the picture, and of course, see this. Layers, upper mantle, but I choose to focus at the outer core, inner core. So it's on a depth at about 3,000 kilometers, and look at this Earth's core. It is divided into outer, this is this yellow part of this picture, and the both of them contain iron. You know, iron is a ferromagnetic metal, and the core is liquid. And you have to know that in this place there's of course a very high very pressure, but also a very high temperature. Maybe you'd like to ask how many degrees centigrade is there in the outer core. So you can answer using chat. So hot is the yellow part, the outer core. down, and I will try to explain next. The outer liquid, but the inner core is solid. Because of the pressure, the high pressure, and that's why, of course, suppose the inner core is solid.
Sunt corect.
If you know our packages ARIS in project ARIS, we have also a package about ARIS. And then you can find out how we know that the outer core is liquid and the inner core is solid. So I don't want to guess hot is there, so I can tell you that it's about 6,000 degrees centigrade. As you know, Earth is still rotating. You know, rotation of the Earth, and the heat, and so the Earth's daily rotation, said that this huge masses of the liquid metal is all still in motion. The Earth is rotating, and the core, liquid outer core, liquid metal, iron, is rotating as well. As you know, iron is a good electric conductor. Yeah, we use iron to conduct electricity. So it is a very good conductor. It's solid or liquid, of course, but it's a conductor. And as a result of this motion, with electric current. You can say that we have a really big power station in the Earth. Yes, that's true. So iron is rotating, and it becomes a lot of electricity light. And look at this. The Biot-Savart's law, electric current is surrounded by a magnetic field. If you have a battery and a piece of conductor, you can put it to your end where this electric current inside your conductor, you can find out that it becomes a magnet. And same situation. We have a lot of electricity inside the Earth, and that's why it becomes a huge magnet. So I hope that now we have this magnetic field, geomagnetic field. Yes? I hope. So look at the next. That sun produces not only light, not only UV radiation, but also are particles, charged electrically charged particles. And comes directly from the sun in space, and also they go to our planet. But if you look carefully, there is a strange fluctuation around our planet. These particles are influenced by something. Sun is changing their motion, and this is just magnetosphere. If you look at the definition, the area or the size where electrically charged particles from the space are mainly influenced by the geomagnetic field, the magnetosphere. So, if you have your worksheet printed, look at exercise 2. There's a question. Answer the following question based on information you have got during the lecture. And the first question is, what is a magnetosphere? Once you have your card printed, you can write down it just as a note from our lesson. So if you have, I think you need a few seconds to write down this information, because I think it's quite important information. The area where electrically charged particles from the space are mainly influenced by the geomagnetic field, this magnetosphere. This. I hope it's enough time to do it. Okay, but why do researchers about magnetosphere? Is it very important for us, or maybe it's just loss of time? Of course, it's not loss of time, because this magnetic, just magnetosphere, we say that it's a natural shield, and it protects us, all of us, our planet, plants, animals, humans, against this harmful nuclear radiation, which comes mainly from the sun. So we name it the polar wind. The important function of our magnetosphere is protection against the solar wind. Okay. Next. Okay, you can see this antique, but this old shield in the upper part of my set of my presentation. I'd like you to remember that the magnetosphere and this shield, so it's very, very similar, because Earth's magnetosphere is a kind of the shield protects us. So as you can see, particles they can't go through our magnetosphere. Not just they can't go directly through our atmosphere, but they are attracted by it by their course and along field lines. So remember what the magnetic field lines, and that's why, as you see in the picture, they drift along these lines. So they go directly to the magnetic poles. That's why in the polar region, we can observe a phenomenon called polar lights, or just the aurora. So aurora can be observed only near this. In this, of course, sometimes I remember that maybe one year ago we could observe the aurora also in Poland. But it is very rare. So really large amount of this radiation to see it in our latitude. But this phenomenon is very common just in polar region. That's why, particles, charged particles, goes along field, magnetic field lines. Okay, so I hope it is quite clear. I hope, of course. You can see how polar light generated. This is another question from our from worksheet. This is C. How are polar lights created? So I will try to explain you, and I would like you to write down information to find this card. Polar wind particles and atmosphere, as I told you, along these geomagnetic field lines, and there they meet with gas molecules, nitrogen and oxygen, and the atoms molecules, gas molecules, absorb energy, and that's why they emitting light. Of course, the color of polar lights depends on these molecules, gas molecules. So we have different color of nitrogen or oxygen, but also it depends on the height of the collision. So we can observe the auroras between 80 to 600 kilometers above Earth's surface. So I think you need seconds just to write down this information about how are polar lights generated. So you can write down this, that solar wind particles enter the atmosphere along geomagnetic field lines, where they collide with gas molecules, nitrogen and oxygen, and their atoms absorb energy, which is emitted in the form of light. This as a light. Break just to write down. Raise your volume. Okay. I think it's enough time. Also, if you need something to read details, you can download our presentation from ERIS project page. It's everything is for you, so you can back to this presentation and to analyze in details what I'm trying to tell you. Okay. Okay, so let's see next. Wow, magnet storm, geomagnetic storm. When scientists measure the intensity of geomagnetic field, they observe very intense perturbation, and this is just geomagnetic storm. What is the reason of this storm? So we you to understand it, because we measure not eruption plasma none observed also, but in magnetism we measure the distance of the magnetic field. The perturbation called magnetic storm is caused by eruption of plasma on the sun. So this phenomenon, this eruption called the coronal mass ejection. Coronal mass ejection is a reason of magnetic storm which we may observe on the planet. Okay, tell me, how long time, what do you think, how long time these particles, this solar wind need to go from the sun to the earth? Today, in this moment, we observe this eruption of plasma, and we can expect that the magnetic storm will be present in our we will observe it. How many minutes, hours, or maybe days? Years. Not years, of course. It's stupid answer, so don't answer the years. But how many minutes? Okay. 8 minutes. But I think that 8 minutes we need to see the light just because I think 8 minutes is time when the light from the sun goes to the earth. So I think when we observe this plasma eruption, observe it after 8 minutes. But but particles need more time to if this coronal mass ejection is directed direct toward the earth, so on this situation this geomagnetic storm occurs, and it's 20 to 70 hours. So you observe this eruption of plasma, so expect that tomorrow or be in 2 days, in 3 days, we can observe a magnetic storm. So or maybe not, but this is very important because the magnetic storm may affect our life in our planet. It makes some problems with GPS, also lights in the Earth's orbit can be damaged. Of course, in the orbit, maybe it, and intense geomagnetic storms can reach power lines and the networks in some regions of globe. So you see in the picture the transformer damage, and through history we have some example that geomagnetic storm may, for example, power lines. I told you when we start our lesson, I told you that I'm sure if our compasses show exactly the north direction. Because you can see in this picture that magnetic poles and geographic poles are not in the same place. Another question in your what's the difference between the geomagnetic and geographic poles? So that you could write down this, that magnetic poles are in the same region, but not exactly in the same place as geographic poles. Now, magnetic poles are situated. The North Magnetic Pole is in northern Canada, and South Magnetic is in the region of Antarctica near Australia. Maybe some, you can see north and where is south, because the rule is that the south magnetic pole is nearby the north geographic pole and vice versa. But to make it easy, just in geography, in education, we say that these are the same. So we can say that North Magnetic Pole and North Geographic Pole are in the same part. So it will, you can, we can tell this. But sometimes, of course, you, in literature you can find out that it's, but I think it's not very important in our lesson. Okay, look at this picture. The position of geomagnetic pole is changing. Still very low, but continuously, slowly but continuously. It's about 10 to 6 kilometers per year. So I think it's quite long distance. We can observe the changes in 1894. So it's quite long distance where okay. This is very interesting. If it's possible that geomagnetic poles can change their position, just exchange their position, that our north magnetic pole became a south magnetic pole, south magnetic pole became a north magnetic pole. Yes. Unfortunately, it's possible. In the history, in our we measured this in the rock. So, from investigation in rock magnetism, we know that many times in Earth history, this magnetic north, north magnetic pole, they change their positions. Of course, the last last reversal was 180,000 years ago, so it was a long time ago, and we cannot predict where can start time. As you can see, this is the on this diagram you can see black and white periods. So the black periods are they are today, and the white inverted poles. So as you can see, this term today is the longest. Of course, it may occur any time. We don't know, and we don't know what would be the problem. And during the last 5 million years, the poles reversed about 20 times. And we, of course, we can, we don't know where can it be next time. So as you remember, our show where the magnetic pole is, and not where the geographic pole is. This, okay. Okay, I think. Yes. So, if our compasses show us magnetic pole, we like to know where the north. There is a declination. Declination is an angle between the magnetic and geographic north direction. We say that declination is positive, where our compass shows us on the east side from geographic north, and negative when it shows us in the north direction. And if we declination, show exactly where the geographic pole is, but of course it's different in different parts of our Earth. That's why we should use, if you are a sailor or a navigator, you use this kind of map, this inclination map, and locate localization and read what is the declination. And if you want to do your sheet after my class, after my lesson, this is the first exercise. And but to do it correctly, you need also instructions. So instructions also included in our lesson. And read carefully, you can do this exercise. I think it won't be very complicated to do for you. Sometimes there are some with sharp red compass indication. If you have another magnet, if this magnet nearby the compass will show you the object, a lot of iron, and you put it next to the compass, it doesn't. And all the current just is became. That's why it's just, if you want to use your compasses correctly, you should avoid magnets, you should magnetic objects and also electric current. So we have a question. You ask him, is it reasonable to install a compass ship or a vessel where the vessel the huge mass of iron? So it's to use using a compass on this ship. But the answer is it's not. Compass on vessel on the ship is always in place, so it's stable. You can't move it. And as you see, this bus red and green, and they're made of soft iron, and they are put there just for compensation of the magnetic field of the vessel, of this ship. So if we know how of ship in because we can compensate it using the green and red balls. So that's of course you can use your one compass which is added into the ship. to conclusion, you can see our Bell Observatory when we measure this genetic field. Of course, we do it manually because a man as observer is so we need to use server, and we do it every day. And all our data goes to the network of magnetic observatories. It is intermagnetic. And after our lesson, you can print. You can print your work. Okay, I can see it here. And there's another exercise where you can look at this magnetogram, Bell's observatory, but not only from the Bell's. We have three of this, because in Poland we have three observatories of magnetism. Maybe not all of them are in Poland, as you can see this point Belsk, and this is the Polish observatory in Spitsbergen. So, are really, really far north. And you should, using your using these magnetograms, you should read differences between high and low intensity of geomagnetism, and then answer the question. And you should find out and write Polish Polar Station in the Shurken. Some more information if you are interested in our subject. Of course, first of all, you can use our ARIES page, where you find more materials about the magnetic field and also about other packages. I think these materials are quite good. And if you are interested, you can visit our magnet network, find out some more information, and if you are from other countries, you can find station just near your home. So I think it's enough for today. Thank you very much. Thank you for your attention. Maybe if you have some questions, I can wait a minute. But thank you very much. And I think have a nice day. Okay, thank you very much. So thank you for hosting. I can close our lesson. Thank you very much. Bye.